Hello and welcome back, students. For today's video, we will be discussing about the venipuncture complications in PMLS2. A few reminders before you start watching the video lecture. Number one, please take down notes. A soft copy of this presentation has been added into your smart kits. Second is listen attentively, avoid unnecessary distractions. And third one, give extra attention to info marked with a star because it is a recall question in the board exam. Here are our learning objectives for Module 16. So first is identify patient complications that may arise during venipuncture and describe methods to handle each situation. Second is discuss the procedure to follow when a patient develops syncope or fainting spells during the venipuncture procedure. Third is explain the areas to be avoided during the venipuncture. And fourth one is explain the technical complications that may be encountered as well during venipuncture. Okay, so as a medical technologist, we are trained to perform venipuncture, which is yun nga, yung pagkuha ng dugo sa ugat. And there are certain complications that you may encounter inside the laboratory because hindi naman almost all of the time talaga is tama yung pwede natin gawin. There are tendencies that we may be able to make mistakes or mga mistakes na hindi naman tayo parang tayo talaga yung gumawa. So, pwedeng outside factors yung pwedeng mag-affect nun. So, what are these complications that you may encounter inside the laboratory when it comes to venipuncture? So, first is, let's discuss patient-related complications. So, this is directly related to the patients itself. So, first possible scenario that you may encounter in the laboratory are those patients that are apprehensive. Apprehensive are those yung parang natatakot, naiisip nila agad may maling magagawa or natatakot sila na merong harm na mabigay sa kanila during the venipuncture procedure. If this happens, if you encountered an apprehensive patient, what you can do first is ask the help of the nurse who is taking care of the patient to help calm the person, especially if they are very emotional. So, if you as yourself, hindi mo makakayang makontrol yung situation, of course, you can always ask the help of our other healthcare professionals in the healthcare system. So, pwede nga may kasama tayo dong nurse. But if ever naman, of course, na kaya mo na on your own to handle apprehensive patients, try as much as you can to handle the situation on your own. Okay, so bago tayo hihingi ng tulong sa iba, of course, kailangan i-handle muna natin on our own as a good medical technologist. Also, assistance from a nurse or parent is required when getting blood from a child. So, yung mga children natin, most of the time, they are very scared when with needles kasi yun nga, tutusukan sila. So, natatakot sila. So, if ever talaga na nagwawala na si child or si kid, you can always ask for the help of the parent itself. So, pwede nyong ipahawak ng maigi sa parent para hindi masyado magpumiglas. Or if ever that the parent is not available or the parent itself is not enough po to control the child, you can always ask the other healthcare professionals in the laboratory, which can be a nurse or your other co-medical technologist. Also, phlebotomists also may require nursing assistance when encountering patients in fixed positions such as those in traction or body cast. So, yung mga nakafix yung position nila, like hindi sila makagalaw due to certain tendencies like traction nga or may yung iba may body cast, you can of course always ask the help of other healthcare professionals. Okay, another patient-related complication. Here we have fainting or syncope in other term. So, fainting spells o yung nahihimatay is the spontaneous loss of consciousness caused by insufficient blood flow to the brain. So, yung mga patient suffering from fainting spells during venipuncture, most of the time sila yung takot na takot kasi sila or sobra silang kinakabahan na halos hindi na sila makahinga. And what can happen is, due to insufficient blood flow to the brain, sometimes they may lose their consciousness. Yun yung fainting spells or syncope. Triggers such as the sight of blood, lalo na yung mga takot na takot sa dugo, having blood drawn, yung feeling ng lumalabas yung dugo tas nakikita nila. There are of course persons talaga na sobrang takot talaga nila sa dugo, talagang there's tendency talaga na ma-faint sila or mahimatay. Fear of bodily injury, ayan, may mga ganyang person, standing for long periods of time, especially kapag mahaba yung queue inside the laboratory, like mahaba yung pila, so ang tagal na nilang nakatayo, tas mainit, So, of course, pwedeng mahimatay sila. And heat exposure, ayan, yung mga very sensitive sa heat, yung masyadong mainit na surroundings, they're very prone to fainting spells. And exertion can cause vasovagal syncope. Other conditions that can cause a person to faint include postural hypotension, dehydration, low blood pressure, heart disease, anemia, hypoglycemia, and neurological disorders. But these are just a few examples. There are many, many more triggers for fainting. But the best thing that you can do as a phlebotomist, once you encounter the patient who have fainting spells or syncope, and again, in this case, this may be due to dizziness and as well as the other factors that was mentioned earlier. What you can do if they are ayan, nakahiga sa sahig, you can always raise their legs and you can give them yung parang inaamoy para mawala-wala yung hilo nila. Kasi most of the time, kaya talaga sila nahimatay is nahilo sila bigla, parang ganon. Then, what you can do again, first thing, pag nakahiga sa sahig, you can actually raise their legs po. Okay, so yan. This is not a rare encounter in the laboratory actually. Fainting spells is hindi naman siya yung parang mga sobrang madalas, pero hindi siya rare mangyari. Okay, hindi rin naman siya common. Pero magkakaroon at magkakaroon ng patients talaga na ma-encounter nyo, biglang mahihimatay sila. So, yun nga, just help the patient nga. Of course, first is to raise their legs and address kung ano pa yung nararamdaman nila. Okay, another patient-related complication, we have patients who may experience seizures during venipuncture. It's rare. This seizures is very rare in general, hindi lang naman sa venipuncture, but in general, seizures is very rare in normal patients or healthy patients. But if this situation occurs, the tourniquet and needle should be removed immediately, pressure applied to the site, and help summoned. Restrain the patient only to the extent that the injury is prevented. Please do not attempt to place anything in the patient's mouth. There is this tendency of non-medical people, especially, of course, they are not properly educated. When someone is experiencing seizures, nilalagyan nila ng parang something sa bibig para daw hindi makagat yung dila. But that's actually a wrong practice. Okay? Baka kasi ang mangyari, imbis na matulungan natin sila, mag-choke pa sila dun sa nilagay natin sa mouth nila. So again, this does not necessarily na connected lang sa venipuncture. When someone is experiencing seizures, please do not place anything in the patient's mouth. Okay? Any very deep puncture caused by sudden movement by the patient should be reported to our physicians. And please document the time of the seizure started and stop according to institutional policy. But the best thing that we can do here is just to prevent injury. Like, lagyan nyo sila ng unan sa may ano nila, sa may ulo nila para hindi magbang yung head nila sa floor or kung saan mang malapit. Okay? Kasi once someone is experiencing seizures, you cannot actually do anything about it as a medical technologist aside from helping the patient to prevent the injury. Okay? Just let it pass. Yun. Kahit hindi lang sa venipuncture to, anyone that is experiencing seizure, let it pass. Hayaan nyo silang magninig-ninig muna. Don't, yun nga, please do not place anything in the patient's mouth because it may be a choking hazard instead of helping them. Kasi hindi naman totoo yung makakagat nila yung dila nila. Hindi po yun totoo when it comes to seizures. Okay, another patient-related complication is person suffering from petechia or petechiae. So, petechiae are small, non-raised, red hemorrhagic spots. So, petechiae nga yung tawag doon, para siyang ganito. And that may be serve as an indication of a coagulation disorder such as low platelet count or abnormal platelet function. Additional pressure should be applied to the puncture site following needle removal if the patient is prone to petechiae or petechia. So, si petechiae po, ganyan yan. Di ba kasi pag tutusok tayo dito sa area na ito, sometimes if a patient is suffering from coagulation disorders, mas malaki yung tendency nila to form petechiae. Mukha tong parang para siyang kagat-kagat na kulay pula. Ayan nga, non-raised red hemorrhagic spots. Those are petechiae. So again, what you can do if you have noticed that the patient is experiencing petechiae during venipuncture, apply additional pressure should be applied to the puncture site following the needle removal. So, para hindi rin naman masyadong mag-form ng mga ganitong non-raised red hemorrhagic spots niya. So, this can be prevented naman at hindi mag-worsen. Okay, just the same for patient-related complications pa rin tayo. We have those persons that may experience allergies during venipuncture. Patients are occasionally allergic to alcohol. So, some people are allergic to alcohol. Iodine, yung ginagamit din natin panlinis. Latex gloves. So, minsan maski yung gloves nyo, they can be allergic to it. Or the glue used in adhesive bandages. Necessary precautions must be observed by using alternate antiseptics if ever that they are allergic to the alcohol or iodine, which are commonly used disinfecting agent inside the laboratory. Most of the time naman, if the patient actually knows that he or she is allergic to alcohol or yung betadine, sinasabi naman nila yun agad. So, pwede nyo lang naman gawin doon pag sinabi lang, medtech, ano po kasi ako, allergic ako sa alcohol tsaka sa betadine. So, hanap ka ngayon ng alternative antiseptic that you can use. Also, paper tape or self-adhering wrap known as Coban and non-latex products can be used if ever that they are allergic to the equipments that you are using. So, yung latex kasi, ang latex is madalas na component ng ating mga gloves na ginagamit inside the laboratory. So, if a patient said to you na, ma'am, yung ano, sa latex po, ako'y allergic. So, hanap ka ngayon ng alternative na pwede mong gamitin kay patient because we don't want them to have allergies during venipuncture. Baka kasi maging life-threatening yung allergy nila. Okay? And next, another patient-related complications that you may encounter in the laboratory is vomiting. So, yung pagsusuka. Once a patient have actually vomited during venipuncture, instruct the patient to breathe deeply and slowly and apply cold compress to the patient's forehead. If the patient vomits, just stop the blood collection immediately and provide the patient with an emesis basin or waste basket and tissues. So, ang ating pong mga pasyente, ito hindi naman to really, really common, no? I haven't encountered a patient who have vomited during venipuncture. But if ever this happens to you, just help them na maglagay ka doon ng basin or yung pwede niyang sukahan. So, pwede yung basurahan, di ba? Itapat mo sa kanya para doon siya makasuka. And of course, provide tissues as well. Kasi hindi rin naman nila ginusto yung mangyari. If ever na there is an outpatient na yun yung nag-vomit, give outpatient water to rinse out his or her mouth and a damp washcloth to wipe the face. So, di ba, parang common lang din. If someone na nagsuka, di ba, sa harapan nyo, even if not venipuncture or due to venipuncture, tutulungan nyo pa rin sila, of course. Yun nga, bigyan nyo sila ng water, di ba, para mag-rinse yung mouth and also bigyan nyo ng wet wipes or damp washcloth para malinis nila yung face nila. Notify the patient's nurse or designated first aid personnel or yung requesting physician. So, if ever na nag-vomit sila during venipuncture. Siguro kaya sila nag-vomit niyan, kinakabahan sila or di kaya yung site of blood, hindi nila matake yung site of blood, nasusuka sila pag nakakita sila ng dugo. So, that can happen. Okay, so for additional patient observation, observe for patient changes which may include the presence of vomit, urine, or feces, infiltrated or removed IV fluid lines, extreme breathing difficulty, and possibly a patient who has expired or has died. So this certain scenario, I have actually encountered this before in my internship training. Like, kukuhanan ko siya ng dugo, kaso paglapit ko sa kanya, hindi na siya gumagalaw, tas medyo malamig na yung katawan niya. So, alam na natin yung ibig sabihin nun. If that's the case that happens to you, that you have encountered, yun nga, yung nag-expire na, unfortunately, you can always document it in the requisition form and then inform our nurse or yung kung sino man attending physician sa kanya in the lab, in the hospital. Okay, next. Another patient-related complication that you may encounter in the laboratory is this one, patient refusal or yung ayaw nila magpakuha sa inyo ng dugo. Please remember that our patients have the right to refuse blood withdrawal for whatever reason kung ayaw talaga nila, although we persuaded them already and explained na natin na sobrang kailangan nitong venipuncture na to para sa health nila kasi kunari, minomonitor sila ng doctor, but still they refuse to get blood withdrawn to them. it's okay. Just remember that everyone has the right to refuse, okay? So, just like yourself, kung ayaw nyo sa isang bagay, pwede naman kayo mag-refuse, diba? Just the same with our patients when it comes to venipuncture. The phlebotomist can stress to the patient that the results are needed by the healthcare provider or the doctor for treatment and discuss the problem with the nurse, who may be able to convince the patient to agree to have the test performed. So, kahit ano ng pagmamakaawa mong ayaw niya talaga na kuhanan siya ng dugo for whatever reason, okay lang yon. If the patient continues to refuse even after persuading him or her, this decision should be just written on the requisition form. So, pwede niya naman yun isulat doon sa request form niyo that the patient refused venipuncture. At wala na kayong kasalanan doon, kumbaga. And the form should be left at the nursing station or the area stated in the institution policy. So, this really depends no, kung saan kayo nag-work. But, kung ayaw talaga ni patient, wala kayong magagawa about it. Okay? It's not your fault. It will not be your fault as long as you documented na nag-refuse si patient. Okay? Kapag kasi hindi nyo yan nilagay dun sa request form nyo at hindi nyo dinocument na nag-refuse si patient, pwede kasing bumalik yun sa inyo. Like, sasabihin niya, bakit hindi mo kinuwanan yung patient? Eh, wala ka namang sinabi or hindi mo naman nilagay doon sa request form na nag-refuse siya, sa'yo hahanapin yan yung resulta. Kaya it's best to document what happened if a patient ever refuses your request for venipuncture. Okay, second is areas to be avoided during venipuncture. We have discussed this before in the previous module, sa module 12 to 15. So, just a few reminder lang, ano ba yung mga areas na kailangan nyong i-avoid. At kapag ganito yung nakita nyong scenarios, choose an alternative site for venipuncture. Diba nga, kapag arms, pag hindi pwede sa kabilang arm, doon ka sa kabilang arm. Pag both arms, hindi available, hands. Tapos pag hindi rin pwede both hands, sa feet ka na ngayon kukuha. At kung wala dun sa tatlong yon, pwede mo na yung i-endorse sa doctor, diba? But still, let's just remind you guys what are the areas to be avoided during venipuncture. Number one is of course, damaged veins. Kapag po, kita nyo yung vein niya talaga, halos wala na, puro pasana and everything, of course, wag ka na dun kukuha. Second is hematomas, or diba, yung namamaga, tas may pamamasa, hindi na yun dapat kuhanan. Third one is the edematous area, yung namamanas, di ba? Yung namamaga due to accumulation of fluid. So, if that's the case, hanap ng alternative site. Because it may be prone to dilution if ever that you use a blood that is contaminated with edematous fluid. Fourth one is the burned area should be avoided. Scars, di ba? Yung scars, it is very difficult to penetrate at nahihirapan kayo kumuha ng dugo. And of course, guys, those areas with tattoos. If ever that the patient have tattoo in the area kung saan kayo magpapuncture, please choose an alternative site. Okay? Although, don't get me wrong, kapag may tattoo naman si patient, of course, pwede nyo siyang kuhanan ng dugo. Just make sure na hindi kayo doon mismo sa tattoo kukuha ng dugo. Okay? Hanap kayo ng alternative site. But, of course, pwede sila kuhanan. Then, fifth one we have, of course, is the mastectomy patient. Diba, mastectomy is the surgical removal of the breast. And in cases nga, diba, double mastectomy, left and right breast tinanggal, the physician should be consulted first as to an appropriate site, such as the hands. So, it may be possible to perform the test from a finger stick with a physician's permission. But just to make sure that if ever nga si patient have double mastectomy, ask the physician or the doctor first kung saan siya best kuhana. The sixth one is yung mga obese patients natin. Sometimes when an area is surrounded by fat, it may be hard to detect the veins kung saan kayo tutusok. So, if that's the case, palpate nyo lang maigi yung area. Kasi, di ba, kapag medyo chubby-chubby si patient, talagang yung buong katawan niya, di ba, is somehow medyo malalalim yung veins. So, kahit saan kayo tumingin niya. So, the best thing that you can do if someone is very difficult to perform the venipuncture due to this reason, palpate nyo pong maigi yung kanyang arm. So, di kaya you can actually tighten a little bit yung ating tourniquet. So, para lalabas yung vein niya. Next one is IV therapy. Diba? This was discussed in the previous discussion. Kapag anong gagawin nyo kapag may IV, as well as heparin and saline locks. as well as cannulas and fistulas. So these are the areas to be avoided during venipuncture. Okay, third one is the technical complication. So yung mga pinag-usapan natin kanina, patient-related, so si patient mismo yon. Second is the areas that you should avoid during the venipuncture. Third one is the complications that is inflicted by our phlebotomists themselves. Okay, so technical meaning, this has something to do with your technique, kung bakit ka nag-fail or bakit magkakaroon ng complications when performing venipuncture. So, failure to obtain blood. There are many possible reasons why you will not be able to get blood in a certain person. But do not get me wrong, guys. There will be days talaga na hindi kayo makakakuha ng blood. Okay, kahit sobrang expert nyo na sa venipuncture, there will always be a day na may hindi ka makukuhanan ng blood. Okay, maraming pwedeng factor yon kung bakit hindi ka makakuha ng blood in a certain patient. But of course, guys, it does not necessarily mean naman na hindi lang kayo nakakuha ng blood once, hindi na kayo magaling na medtech. Okay, it really happens talaga. As humans, we are prone to mistakes. So, don't be too hard on yourself, especially right now, mga newbies, mga first-year college students kayo, don't be hard on yourself if ever na hindi kayo nakapag-obtain ng blood for venipuncture. Just take note of these scenarios para in the next time around, if ever nga na mag-fail kayo to obtain blood, pwede nyo nang maitama sa susunod yung gagawin. Okay, so first, failure to obtain blood may possibly due to the needle position. Diba ang needle natin should be 15 to 30 degree yung angle. So, pag masyadong mataas yung angle mo, pwedeng kasi mangyari doon is hindi mo matusok yung vein. Or matusok mo man si vein pero magto-true and true ka. Kumbaga, malalagpasan mo siya. Kaya dapat nga, needle position is very, very important in venipuncture. Again, that is 15 to 30 degree angle. Next is bevel against the wall of the vein. Just like this. Ito po. Bevel against the vein wall, kumbaga, hindi mo pa talaga totally na-penetrate yung vein, pero nandun ka na. Kaso akala mo, hindi mo talaga na-hit yung vein. Yun pala, nandun ka na sa wall niya. Hindi mo lang, ang kailangan mo lang gawin dyan para makakuha ka is ilalim mo lang maigay yung tusok. Of course, kasi guys, yung mga anatomy ng arms natin, iba-iba yan. There are certain veins na malalalim, there are certain veins na superficial. And bevel against the vein wall, sometimes this may be due to malalim yung ugat nila. So, akala mo hindi na tama yung posisyon kung saan mo siya tinusok. Yun pala na dun ka lang sa vein wall. So, pe-penetrate mo lang, ipapasok mo lang maigi yung needle niyan, makakakuha ka na. Also, needle that is too deep. So, sumobra naman yung needle mo. Instead na nandun ka lang sa vein wall, talagang sumobra ka. So, once na sumobra kasi din ang needle, of course, hindi ka makakakuha ng dugo kasi dapat nandun lang tayo sa tamang site for venipuncture. The next one, needle that is too shallow naman. Ayan, no? Needle not in the vein, masyadong shallow lang yung iyong pagtusok. Yun pala, kailangan mo lang laliman. What you can do is just move forward. Ayan, move forward the needle. And also, yung mga collapsed vein natin, yung mga masyado nang maninipis kasi marami ng beses kinukuhanan, so nagko-collapse na yung vein. Of course, kung malaki yung needle mo katulad nito, just like in this illustration, halos hindi na magkasya yung needle natin doon sa vein just because collapse na siya. So, just hanap ng alternative site if you have noticed that the vein is already collapsed. The needle beside the vein, ayun nga, hindi lang nakapasok, kailangan mo lang laliman, and also faulty evacuated tube or maling evacuated tube naman yung ginamit mo. Kunwari, ibang test pala ang nire-request sa ibang blood collection tube mo siya nilagay. So, failure na yun agad. That is a technical complication. Kukuha ka ulit ng panibago. Kaya nga dapat, as a medical technologist, you know po kung anong mga blood collection tubes ang kailangan for the different tests. Okay? So, next po tayo. Yan, common complications again, potential problems, ayun nga, depth or the angle of the needle is resulting in no blood or very little blood being drawn. That's why the angle of our needle is very vital during venipuncture. Okay, so again, that is 15 to 30 degree angle. So, di ba katulad dito, masyadong superficial, yan, hindi enough. ito naman, sumobra naman, nag-true and true na dun sa vein ko, nakikita nyo, di ba, lumagpas na. So, pwede yung mangyari pag masyadong malalim yung tusok or masyadong mataas yung angle nyo. And this one naman, nandun ka lang sa vein wall. So, suggested actions if this happens. So, if ever man, kunwari, pag tusok nyo, wala agad backflow yung ating hub, change the position of the needle. You can move it forward or it may be not in the lumen. Or, you move it backward if ever naman na nag-true and true ka, katulad nito. Or adjust the angle. The bevel may be up against the vein wall. So, those are the suggested actions if ever na pagtusok nyo, wala agad backflow kayong makikita. Huwag kayo ganong magpanic. Like, yung iba kasi ang nangyayari sa kanila, pagtusok nila, wala sila agad nakita na backflow. Akala nila na miss na nila agad yung vein. Yun pala, may mga ganito lang scenarios na nagawa nila. And these are, again, the suggested actions for those. So, yan. Huwag masyadong panghihinaan ng loob, ha, kapag if ever na pagtusok nyo, wala agad backflow. Hanapin nyo lang ng very, very light. Nandyan lang yung ugat na yan. Kung alam nyo namang tama yung tinusukan ng ating needle, most probably nandun lang naman din yung vein niya. Okay, another technical complication during venipuncture is the collection attempts. Please take note that a certain phlebotomist have a maximum 2 chances only for venipuncture. If the second puncture po is not successful, the same phlebotomist should not make another attempt. So, kunwari ako, si medtech, twice na ako tumutusok kay patient at hindi talaga ako nakakakuha for whatever reason, please po ha, huwag na kayo ulit mag-attempt kumuha. Tawag na po kayo ng endorsement. Following the hospital policy, the phlebotomist should notify the nursing station and request that another phlebotomist perform the venipuncture. Okay, so again, max of 2 attempts only in one person. So, ako kunwari si Ma'am Lena, pumunta ako sa patient ko, tas twice na akong tumusok sa kanya at hindi ako nakakuha. That's the time to endorse the patient to another phlebotomist. Okay, so wag na mag-attempt ha, wag na mag-attempt ng 3. Okay lang naman yung twice, okay lang yon. Pag yung twice talaga hindi ka pa nakakuha, tawag ka na po ng endorsement for another phlebotomist. Next, here another technical complication that you may encounter is the nerve injury. Temporary or permanent nerve damage can be caused by incorrect vein selection or improper venipuncture technique and may result in loss of movement to the arm or hand and the possibility of a lawsuit. The most critical permanent injury in the venipuncture procedure is damage to the median antibrachial cutaneous nerve. So here in this area, this is diba the anticubital fossa. So diba nandito yung mga veins of choice natin, si median, si basilic at si cephalic. And of course, since merong mga veins dyan, there is also those possibility na mga nerve endings dyan. Or yung mga nerves themselves, nandyan po sila. Diba? Sa buong katawan naman natin, may nerve. So, dito rin of course, si anticubital fossa, meron pong mga present na nerve dyan. At pag kayo po is nagkamali ng tusok, at yung natusukan nyo is yung nerve natin, this is not a very common encounter, but if ever that you have actually punctured the median antibrachial cutaneous nerve, somehow that is a permanent injury that can result in a lawsuit or yung pwede kayong kasuhan. Kasi po, mangyayari dyan kapag na-puncture natin siya or talagang nasira natin yung nerve, magkakaroon po ng loss of sensation in that area. So, paralysis ang mangyayari. Pwede kayo magkaroon ng lawsuit if ever that happens. But do not worry guys, this area, yung nerve na present in the anticubital area, hindi naman siya talaga sobrang parang prone na matusok nyo. Just make sure lang talaga na vein yung matutusok nyo and you will not have any problem with this nerve injury. Okay, another technical complication, we have iatrogenic anemia. This pertains to a condition of blood loss caused by a treatment. An anemia can occur when large amounts of blood are removed for testing at one time or over a period of time. That's why if you will be collecting blood from a certain patient, just collect enough sample. Huwag yung sobrang dami, di ba? Natuwa ka lahat ng blood collection tubes katulad nito. Pinuno mo galing sa isang patient, tas one time mo lang siya tinusukan, okay? Just collect the right amount po. Kung ano lang ang kailangan, yun lang ang dapat nyong kukuhan yung blood. Okay? Yan, medyo excited pa kayo nyan, di ba? Lalagyan nyo lahat ng blood collection tubes nyo. pwedeng pong maging prone si patient sa iatrogenic anemia if ever nakuha kayo ng kuha ng blood sa kanya. O at a one time nga or over a period of time. Kaya po kayo, kung magpa-practice na nga kayo for venipuncture, kuha lang po kayo ng enough blood lang. Huwag yung sobrang dami. Okay? And of course, hemolyzed sample, katulad nito. Ayan, hemolysis nga. Pag hemolyzed ang sample, automatic yan, recollect po yan. Automatic rejection in the laboratory, tapos recollect nyo na agad yung sample. Kukuha na naman kayong panibago. And if that happens, maiinis sa inyo yung patient nyo yan, like, bakit tutusukan mo na naman ako? Diba? So, dapat, ano lang, integrity ng sample is very important in the laboratory. Especially yung mga hemolyzed nga. Hindi pwede yan. And then, another technical complication, we have the reflux of anticoagulant. Reflux of a tube and anticoagulant can occur when there is blood backflow into a patient's vein from the collection tube. This can cause adverse reaction in the patient. Keeping the patient's arm and the tube in a downward position, allowing the collection tubes to fill from the bottom up, eliminates this problem. So, nangyari kay reflux nga of anticoagulant, galing sa blood collection tube nyo, bumalik po, nagkaroon ng backflow pabalik sa vein. At since ang ating mga blood collection tubes, meron pong mga anticoagulant yan, yung mga anticoagulant na yun din, kapag nag-backflow siya pabalik sa vein ni patient, papasok din sa vein ni patient yung anticoagulant na present in the blood collection tube. So, yun yung reflux of anticoagulant. Okay, so that's it for Module 16. Thank you for listening. If you have any questions or clarifications, you may contact me in this email.